So today we're looking at a complete examination of the lumbar spine. The lumbar spine examination aims to rule out any serious pathology and any red flags, as well as any neurological impairment that may be leading towards the pain presentation. Once we've done that, we'll be looking to try and identify the cause of the mechanical back pain, if possible, and having a look at what specific structures and areas might be exacerbating the pain presentation. So first of all, we're having a look at observation. If we've seen the patient come through the door, we may see them walking. If not, we'll just start off asking them, make sure we can see the exposed area, and ask them to walking up and down. So just up towards the blue, and back again. We're just gonna quickly flip the screen for a neurological. So walking up on your heels on the way up. So if there's any L4, L5 impairments, that will become quite difficult for the patient. And on your toes on the way back, looking for any L5, S1. Good. Next quick screen we're just going to do is some myotomal testing. So from here, we're having a look at any specific weaknesses through the different myotomes that come from the lumbar spine. So having a look at L1 to start with, so hip flexion towards me. Good. And bringing your knees together. L2. L3, have a look at knee extension, so kick out towards me. Good. L4, we're going to have a look at dorsiflexion, so foot up towards. L5, just big toe extension. And S1, looking at everting, so bringing your foot out towards me. Good. If we think there's a sensory component as well, we can have a feel through quick sensory tests from one side compared to the other, in the regions that they're complaining of any sensory deficits. So myotomal and dermatomal screen is usually quite useful to get out of the way at the start. Next, we're going to get them standing up, and we're going to have a look through our observations. So looking from the back to start with, make sure that we can see the lumbar spine. Looking generally from the head and the neck position, making sure we've got alignment of the ears on top of the shoulders. Noting any abnormalities when we get down to the lumbar spine, particularly any discoloration, any muscle bulk, or hypertrophy or atrophy from one side compared to the other. Having a feel for PSIS levels. Okay. I'm going to look at iliac crest levels and greater trochanters. And feel for gluteal cleft folds down towards the knee. I'm going to look at the knee creases, any genu valgus or genu varus, and any inversion or eversion down at the heels that may be contributing towards that position. Get to face towards the left. Now we're having a look from the coronal plane to the sagittal plane, looking at alignment, any forward hip posture, ear down towards the shoulder, through the middle of the hips, the knee and the ankle. I'm going to look at a gentle lordotic curve through the cervical spine, thoracic kyphosis, and the amount of lumbar lordosis. We might also be able to see muscle bulk or atrophy through the gluteals, and also having a look for their knee positioning. So we've got equal knees, we've got any genu recurvatum, which may be hyperextended knees, putting the lumbar spine into greater amounts of lordosis. Okay. Once we've had a look at the observations, we're then going to go into some clearing before we move on to our active tests. So to clear the areas that may be causing pain presentation in the lumbar spine, mainly the hip joint and the sacroiliac joint. So firstly with the hip joint, we'll do this on both sides, but I'll just show on one for now. Having a look at scouring tests through the hip joint with internal and external rotation. Then if we think there might be a presence of FAI, and have a look at flexion and internal rotation, and then look at the range and the presence of apprehension with the patient. Then have a look at the SIJ. For that, we can have a look at some shearing through the hip, see if there's any presence, any pain posteriorly in the SIJ region. And we can also have a look at Faber's test. So from here, stabilizing the far hip, and let that drop down. See if there's any pressure on the SIJ region again, or any replication of symptoms. If we're happy that the pain's likely not coming from those two areas, we're going to have a look at some active movements in standing. So again, we'll need to be able to just make sure that this area is exposed so we can see it. Just take a small step forward. And we're going to get the patient to reach forward. First of all, we're going to go down into flexion. Having a look at quality of movement, having a look at range of movement, any apprehension, see if there's anything through that painful arc in flexion, and that seems okay. Then you'll ask the patient to place their hands on the back of their hamstrings, and from here, we're going to extend backwards. Looking for any replication of symptoms, again, any aggravation or irritation. So once we've done flexion and extension, we're going to go into side bending. So just take your left hand down your left side. Good. Making sure that they stay in that frontal plane. And the other way. Good. And back up. Now we're going to have a look at rotation. So hands around side. You're going to rotate away from me with some overpressure. In this position, it's quite global rotation. We get that through a number of joints. Good range there. And you get to sit on the side. We just make sure that we limit the rotation down towards the lumbar spine and above by putting the patient in a seated position. From here, with no pressure, and around the other way. Okay. So that's through the active movements with overpressure. We then go on to some of the passive movements, specifically looking at the areas of muscle tone and muscle extensibility, which might be exacerbating some of the symptoms or causing some rotational issues around the pelvis and the lumbar spine. So first of all, we're going to get them just standing off the edge of the table, and I'll have a look at the Thomas test for the hip flexors and iliopsoas, as well as the rectus femoris. So grab a hold of your right knee, stay there. I'm going to take that patient sitting back. From here, having a look at the range of extension through the hip joint. Maybe if we've got limitations in iliopsoas position there, then we're likely to get shortened amount of extension. If we've got problems with the rectus femoris, then we're going to get more knee extension in that position. Yeah. So we're going to feel for both of those positions. So that's looking at hip flexors in that position. Then we're going to get them in a supine position to have a look at glutes and piriformis. So extend that one up. Glute position, so we're looking into extension. From there, looking for quality again, range of movement, making sure that we can get hip flexion without too much lumbar spine movement in that position. And we can also then have a look passively at piriformis. So now piriformis becomes an internal rotator past 90 degrees of hip flexion. So by externally rotating, and have a look for tightnesses there. When we've had a look at the anterior parts, and we've had a look at the glutes there, we can then have a look passively at some flexion extension movements. If they've got issues with flexion extension, then I'll have a feel passively for that position. So laying on your side facing towards me. In this position, exposing the area and palpating for the movement. And I have passively put through the lumbar spine through flexion and extension. Feeling for any apprehension from the patient and any particular areas of limitation that we can explore further with our PIVMs and direct palpation of the lumbar spine joint plate. If that feels okay, then we're going to have a look at sideline facing towards me and do the same thing for rotation. So from here, one leg straight, one leg bent. Very similar fashion, we can passively take the lumbar spine. You know, there's limited rotation through the lumbar spine, but we can have a feel if they've got fairly normal amounts without too much apprehension or limitations with that. So we've gone through our passive movements now. We're now going to have a look at our active assisted movements. So first of all, we're going to have a look at active assisted flexion. Have a feel for the quality of the abdominal muscles. So hands are going to reach down. You can do a sit-up. Hands are going to reach down towards your ankles. Good. Back down. If that feels okay, we can apply a little bit of resistance to that. Good. So checking for rectus abdominis, and we can also see the eccentric strength of that quite easily with asking the patient to hold their legs and then going to slowly lower in that position, keeping their stomach nice and strong. Good, a reasonable eccentric control through the abdominals there. So if we have a look at the flexion control, you're going to place your hands across your chest. I'm going to have a look at rotation now. So taking your left elbow towards your right knee, okay, and apply some resistance. And relax. So in that rotation, we're looking at the external obliques on the left-hand side and the internal oblique strength on the right-hand side, and then vice versa, going in the opposite direction. Good. Right in this position, we're going to have a look at a glute bridge, so general lumbar pelvic control in this position. So you're going to bridge up, okay, looking for symmetries from one side compared to the other. If that's okay, then extending out the left leg. Good, making it a little bit more challenging, back down, and then we can do the same thing on the right leg to test. Yeah. To make this a little bit more challenging, we go into a long bridge, pulling up. Okay, a little bit of difference on one side compared to the other, and dropping down. Good, looking for control through that movement, as well as ability to keep that position stable. That's the ones in supine. Having a look resisted for the extensors, you're going to turn you over. So hands by the side, just place your hip to the side. Comfortable too. Cool. We're going to have a look at lumbar spine extensors now. So hands will come down towards your knees and you're going to extend back towards me. Apply some resistance to that. And if we want to have a look at the endurance, we can ask them to hold it for a set period of time. 45 to 60 seconds if we think that endurance could be an issue. Have a look at the straight leg extension on the left hand side. Good. Back down. Now on this side. Good. I'm going to bias that slightly with a little bit more hamstring extension so we can look at the glutes when we've got a knee bent. Pushing up. Okay. Good. From here, once we've gone through those active resisted movements, we can have a look at palpation. So palpation will focus firstly superficially on the lumbar musculature. So erector spinae in the lower back. You can then look out to the side, where I feel deeper for the quadratus lumborum, in between the lower ribs, the ilium and the lumbar spine. Then we can come centrally into the paravertebral gutter and have a feel for multifidus, either side of the spinous processes. Now onto PSIS. Have a feel of the sacroiliac joint and the iliolumbar ligaments just above that. And then dropping down, a feel for the sacrum into the glute max. And then laterally into the glute med and glute min muscles. Having a look at the presence of trigger points, irritability, and getting an indication of what the muscle tone is like. We'll also have a feel for the ligaments of the sacrotibious and sacrospinous ligaments. And that covers off the palpation. Once we've done the palpation, we can have a look at the final special test that we might look at to rule out any neurological pathology. So laying on your back. We're going to have a look at the straight leg raise. So from this position, we're going to raise the leg up straight. I'm going to apply some dorsiflexion on that as we raise that up, looking for any signs and symptoms of neurology. We can bias towards the tibial or the sural nerve with internal and external, eversion and inversion as we're going into that position. The next one we can do is having a seat off the side. I'm going to look at the slump test. So from that position, hands behind your small of your back. Slump your head and neck down and shoulders, and then we ask you to straighten out that right leg. Good, looking for presence of neurological signs and symptoms. If there is, we can just extend the neck and back down to give us an indication of whether that's a true positive or whether it's just a hamstring tightness. Extend out and back down, and back up. Okay, so we've gone through our movements and cleared out for any neurological issues. And look specifically at what might be causing the lumbar spine pathology, as well as getting an indication of the neuromotor control around the lumbar pelvic region.